Good morning all. Welcome to video lectures from Shivananda Sharma Memorial RV College and ISR Initiative. SSMRV College, one of the premier institutes run by the prestigious RV group of institutions, has come up with a unique initiative to engage students at a time of this unforeseen medical emergency caused by corona outbreak. As a socially responsible institution, we would like to connect academically with students to make the good the losses caused. In this connection, I, Shivakumara N, Department of Commerce, has posted a video on the subject business taxation and the topic assessment of companies and subtopics types of companies, taxable income, rate of income tax, etc. Please watch the video till the end, like, share with your peer groups and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you. I would like to convey the simple method to understand the entire concept in assessment of companies. Let us know this topic, such as the companies, types of companies, and then taxable income, that is computation of total income, along with the rate of income tax, etc., in a brief manner. Thank you. Let us know the definition of companies. According to Companies Act 1956, company as an artificial person created by law having a separate legal entity with perpetual succession and a common sale. As per Section 2, Subsection 17 of the Companies Act 2013, a company means any Indian company or any body corporate incorporate under the law of a foreign country, or any institution or association or body which was assessable or was assessed as a company for any assessment year up to 1970-71, or any institution or association or body, whether incorporated or not, whether Indian or non-Indian, which is declared by general or special order of the Central Board of Direct Taxes to be a company. Let us know the types of companies, such as Indian company, company in which public are substantially interested, widely held company, closely held company, domestic company, foreign company, public sector company, company registered under Section 8 of the Companies Act 2013. Let us know the each types of companies, such as Indian company. Indian company means a company formed and registered under the Companies Act 2013. It includes a corporation established under the Central or State Act, or any institution, association or body which is declared by the Central Board of Direct Taxes to be a company under Section 2, Subsection 17. In the case of the state of Jammu and Kashmir, a company formed and registered under any law for the time being in force in that state is called an Indian company. Second one is company in which public are substantially interested. In the following cases, a company is said to be a company in which public are substantially interested if it is a company owned by the central or state government or the Reserve Bank of India, or in which not less than 40% of shares are held by the government or the Reserve Bank of India, or a corporation owned by the RBI, or it is a company which is registered under Section 8 of the Companies Act 2013, or it is a company having no share capital and it is declared by order of the Central Board of Direct Taxes to be a company in which the public are substantially interested. Widely held company means a company in which the public are substantially interested is known as widely held company. Closely held company means a company in which the public are not substantially interested is referred to as a closely held company. Domestic company, Section 2, Subsection 22A of the Companies Act 2013. Domestic company means an Indian company or any other company which, in respect of its income liable to tax under this act, has made the prescribed arrangements for the declaration and payment within India of the dividends, including dividends on preference shares payable out of such income. Foreign company, Section 2, Subsection 23A of this act. A foreign company is a company which is neither an Indian company nor has made the prescribed arrangements for the declaration and payment of dividends within India. Public sector company, Section 2, Subsection 36A. It means any corporation established by or under any central or state act or a government company as defined in section 2 subsection 71 of the Companies Act 2013. Companies registered under section 8 of the Companies Act 2013. It is a company formed to promote art, charity, commerce, religion or any other useful object, not for profit, and which intends to apply its profit, if any, or other income towards the further improvement of such objects and prohibits the payment of any dividend to its members, such a company can be registered in section 8 of the Companies Act 2013. So we know that company is an artificial person created by law, having a separate legal entity with perpetual succession and a common set. Hence, company does not deal all his activities. A person is required to take care of all the activities of the company. So that the particular person is known as principal officer. So principal officer means the secretary, treasurer, manager or agent of company, or any person connected with the management or administration of the company up to whom the assessing officer has served notice of his intention of treating him as the principal officer of the company. So while assessment of companies, this topic, that is decision status of a company, plays a very important role, without which you are not able to find out the taxable income of companies. Decision status of a company by section 6 subsection 4 of the Companies Act of 2013. The total income of a company depends upon its residential status during the relevant previous year. On the basis of the residential status, companies can be classified into two categories, such as resident companies and non-resident companies. Resident companies, section 6, subsection 3 of the Companies Act 2013. A company is said to be a resident in India in any previous year if it is an Indian company or its place of effective management, shortly POEM, in the year is in India. The place of effective management means a place where key management and commercial decisions that are necessary for the conduct of the business of an entity as a whole are in substance move. A set of guiding principles of place of effective management to determine is also proposed to be issued. These guiding principles of place of effective management is based on a taxpayer likely to be affected by place of effective management, or activities likely to trigger place of effective management, or ambiguity in place of effective management. In case of ambiguity, it is a depend upon the situation, or it is a dilemma, depends upon the applicability, we have to take the decisions. In case of taxpayers likely to be affected by the place of effective management, that in the case of foreign companies having Indian branches, the board meeting should be in India, or in addition in India. In case of in addition should be taken in India and the board of meeting also conducted in India, then it should be a resident company, otherwise non-resident company. In case of foreign subsidiaries of Indian parent company, decision should be taken by a director or executive committee or key management person in India, delegation of authority from India, then it should be a resident company, or depend upon the situation where the place, the functions are performed versus place where decisions are taken. If both are in India, then it should be a resident company, or the maximum functions or the maximum decisions should be taken in India, then obviously it should be a resident company, otherwise it is a non-resident company. In case of foreign company having a global reporting structure within India connection, then regional roles, it is depend upon the group of companies, executive officers or company financial officers sitting in India and approving decisions for the foreign affiliates, then it should be an Indian company, or depend upon the actions to be taken by the entity as a whole or determined. It is also depend upon the any actions which are in India, then it should be a resident company, or it should be treated as a non-resident company. Regional headquarters, the functions carried on in India, for example, a global procurement cell of foreign companies, the function should be in India. In that situation, it is obviously Indian company because the major function should be in India. Or it is depend upon the can presence in another country be used to demonstrate absence of place of effective management in India. In that situation, how effectively the presence there, the entire things, in the outside India, depending upon the how many times they are taken the decisions or they conduct any activities in India. On that basis, we can consider as a resident company or non-resident company. Basically, the function should be carried in India is the base for whether it should be a resident India, resident company or non-resident company. Non-resident companies. A company shall be non-resident if it is non-resident in India during the relevant previous year. It means a foreign company whose control and management is situated wholly or partially outside India will be a non-resident company. One of the important topic which you have to know before solve the problems on assessment of company, that is methods of maintaining books of accounts. There are two important methods on maintaining in the books of accounts, such as cash system and mercantile system. Let us know the two bases or the difference between the cash system and mercantile system. The point number one, that is meaning. In the case of cash system, in this system, to find net profit of the business or profession or actual cash receipts and payments are considered. In the case of mercantile system, in this system, to find net profit of business or profession, income earned and expenses incurred, that means even if they are not received or paid on the due basis, it will be recognized. Second basis adopted by cash system, it is adopted by small business concerns and professions. In case of mercantile system, it is adopted by large business and professions and companies. So simple format of computation of taxable income. So particular amount, then income from house property should be taken, then add if income from business or profession if any, less brought forward business losses for tax purpose, then we have to add it back the capital gains, then income from other sources, then from these total we have to deduct deduction under section 80G to 80LA, remaining balance will be total taxable income. While calculation of income tax of the companies, there are two important bases are there. That is, the rate of income tax which are applicable to companies for the assessment year 2019-20 are as under, in the case of a domestic company, in the case of a foreign company. In case of a domestic company, income such as winnings under section 115 BP, 30% of that taxable income, short-term capital gains specified in section 111A, 15%, long-term capital gains 20% of the taxable income. Other income in a domestic company is taxable at 30%. However, tax rate is 25% if turnover or gross receipt of the company does not exceed rupees 250 crore plus surcharge. 7% of tax where total income exceed rupees 1 crore but does not exceed rupees 10 crores. In case of this exceed 10 crores, 12% of the tax where total exceeds rupees 10 crore, along with health and education says at 4% of tax plus surcharge. In case of a foreign company is taxable at 40% plus surcharge, 2% of tax where total income exceeds rupees 1 crore but does not exceed rupees 10 crore, 5% of tax where total income exceeds rupees 10 crore. Health and education says at 4% of tax plus surcharge. Thank you for watching. I hope you understand the concept in this chapter, that is assessment of companies. And please share in this video lectures in your peer groups, as well as please subscribe our YouTube channel. Thank you once again.